This is Merryn Jose, and you're listening to MerlianPodcast.com. Today we have the great privilege of speaking with Dr. Raymond Moody. Dr. Moody is the leading authority in the area of near-death studies, having coined the phrase near-death experience and penned over 11 books on the subject. His famous book, Life After Life, has sold 13 million copies worldwide and has just been re-released for its 25th anniversary edition. His latest book is Glimpses of Eternity, Sharing a Loved One's Passage from This Life to the Next with Paul Perry, published by Guideposts. Dr. Moody received his MD from the Medical College of Georgia. He also received his PhD, MA, and BA with honors in philosophy from the University of Virginia. Dr. Moody trains hospice workers, clergy, psychologists, and other medical professionals in all aspects of his work. In his private practice, he has also helped thousands of people who are coping with dying and the deaths of their loved ones. Dr. Moody is a regular public speaker and noted authority. He has appeared 3 times on Oprah, as well as on hundreds of other local and nationally syndicated programs. For more, go to Dr. Moody's official site, www.lifeafterlife.com. Welcome, Dr. Moody, to Merlian Podcast. It's so nice to have you with us today.
Well, thank you so much for having me on the program. I'm just really excited about to be here, so thank you.
I've just read your latest book, Glimpses of Eternity, Sharing a Loved One's Passage from This Life to the Next with Paul Perry, and it's absolutely fascinating.
Well, thank you so much. I can say the same thing about all the wonderful people I talked with who've had this experience in which they tell us that they have identically the same elements that we know of as the near-death experience, is someone who almost dies and returns. But in this case of the shared death experiences, all those same elements occur to people at the bedside of the dying. And this is, I think, a finding that will probably very dramatically change the way we debate about this subject. Because, you know, in the past, when these cases were presented of individuals who had almost died and returned with the story of leaving their bodies and going through a passageway into a beautiful light and seeing their deceased relatives, meeting them there in that light and undergoing panoramic memory in which they see all of the events of their lives displayed around them, this kind of experience is by now familiar throughout the world. There was a sort of surface plausibility in saying, well, since these people almost died and since the oxygen was cut off to their brain, maybe it was this event that caused a hallucinatory phenomenon.
Yes.
In the brain, which is reported as a near-death experience. But now that we know that identically that same experience happens to the bystanders who are not ill or injured, it becomes really, really difficult.
And I believe you're the first one to bring this to our awareness by interviewing such a varied group of people.
Yes, actually, this goes back a long, long way. I first heard a living person relate a near-death experience in 1965, that when I was an undergraduate philosophy student at the University of Virginia. But by the time I got to medical school in 1972, which was 7 years after I heard Dr. Ritchie speak about his experience, I already had quite a number of these near-death experiences that I had studied. But in December of 72 or January of 73, right at the end of the first quarter of medical school, or maybe the beginning of the second, I was in the medical school bookstore, and this very nice woman who I hadn't met before introduced herself, and she said, Dr. Moody, I'm Dr. So-and-so, and I recognized the name immediately as an eminent professor in the medical school. She knew me because the faculty had a book with photographs of all the incoming students.
Mm-hmm.
So she could recognize me. And she had known about my work with near-death experiences. And so she told me that she had had an experience some little time before in which she had resuscitated her own mother, who actually did die. And she said as she was resuscitating her mother and she felt her mother die, she said that she herself, this physician, found herself up above looking at her own body down below trying to resuscitate her mother and to see her mother's now deceased body in the bed. And to use her exact words, she said, "I was trying to get my bearings." And she became aware of her mother, again to use her exact words, now in spirit form, there beside her. And she said goodbye to her mother, and she saw her mother recede away into this light and sort of join up with relatives and friends of her mother's who had died previously. So
what an experience to have.
Yes, and I have known about these experiences since 1972, although that was the first one of the empathic or shared death experiences I had heard. And when I first began to hear them, it was almost exclusively from doctors and nurses. And, for example, a very common thing that physicians would tell me was that as a patient died, they would see what appeared to be like a transparent replica of the person, or in some cases like a golden grayish cloud, which nonetheless had a complex structure inside, seemed to sort of lift away from the patient's body and seemed to vanish through the ceiling. And you know, it's interesting that what happened, and anybody who's young is going to have a hard time comprehending this, but I've got to admit that when I entered medical school in 1972, at that time it was the standard procedure that when a patient died, doctors and nurses would come in and sort of escort the family out on the sort of paternalistic idea that it would be too overwhelming for the patient's families. But
how sad.
Yes, it really was. But in the years that I've been in medical practice, I mean, I've seen this in the, 38 years or so, I've seen this transform to where now it's the standard practice that the doctors and nurses try to make themselves scarce and encourage the families to be there to the end. And so that is bringing about a tidal wave of these empathic or shared death experiences, because there are just more people now at the bedside of the dying who can report these things back to us.
And so this will open up the doors for millions of people.
I really do think it will, because one practice that I've had in writing books and presenting information, which has actually worked out very well, is that I don't publish anything until I am absolutely sure that anybody who sincerely started an investigation of what I've written about would be able to confirm it for themselves. And so the reason I'm confident about this is that just long experiences assures me that essentially anybody who asks around among their friends and relatives who've been in this situation of losing someone and being there, I mean, anybody who's a sincere investigator can find cases of this. It's just so common now, partly because, as I said, of the change in the demographics, whereas now, you know, formerly it was the doctors and nurses there at the scene of death, but it's now much more commonly the family who can tell about these things.
I had one with my mother, and I couldn't understand for the minute. I went with her for that moment. And I thought, I've never heard of this, what happened? And then I only got your book maybe a few weeks ago, and I thought, I'm not on my own. It's happened to hundreds of people, and you had an experience with your mother.
I did. It was really interesting because I should say, to put this in context, I am driven very largely by curiosity and have been since I was 7 or 8 years old when I became interested in astronomy. I'm just, I'm fascinated with anything that's hard to comprehend. And so got interested in these near-death experiences when I was in college studying philosophy at the University of Virginia. Then went on after that to become a medical doctor. So I have really spent my life chasing knowledge. And as I mentioned, I had heard the first one of these, shared death experiences in 1972 or so on from one of my professors.
Well, that must have been very interesting for him to speak about that then.
Well, it was. And I was so curious about these things, and I think it was 1994, I had enough information where I saw that this needed to come out, so I was really actively preparing a book and a research project on this, and I was out in a western state with a bunch of other psychologists and medical doctors and so on. And we were trying to figure out some systematic way to investigate these shared death experiences. And this happened to be on Mother's Day in 1994. It was May, I remember. And our meeting was over that afternoon, so I went to the local shopping mall and called by payphone. I called my mom to wish her a happy Mother's Day. And I remember how cheerful her voice was. Chipper is the word I used. I mean, it was just amazing. When she picked up the phone, she said, "Hello," and I was very cheerful. And I said, "Hi, Mom, you know, happy Mother's Day." And I said, "Well, how are you feeling?" And I remember the excitement in her voice. She said, "I feel great." I mean, she was just talking about how great she felt. And she said, "But the previous day she had developed a rash, and my brothers and sisters had taken her down to the doctor at the emergency room, who examined her, and he didn't think it was anything significant. He said some sort of allergy or whatever. Anyway, then as a precaution, he gave her an appointment to see another doctor on the following Monday. So when I talked to her on Sunday, everything was great. And then when she went to the doctor the next day, he said, quote, "You have non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and you have 2 days to 2 weeks to live."
Oh, my goodness.
And indeed, she did die exactly 2 weeks later to the day. And my wife and I were with her throughout this that entire 2 weeks. The last 2 days of her life, she slipped into this comatose-like state. But as she was dying, she sort of... There are people who have seen this know, I mean, it's not... There really aren't words for it. But basically, it's like she came back to life, for want of a better term. And twice she said very clearly, "I love you."
Mm.
And at that point, I myself, along with my wife who was there, and my sister who during this perceived the spirit of my father, who had died 18 months before, my other sister had some sort of experience, and again, my words fail. I mean, but for want of a better term, it's like instead of the cubicle that we were in, which is a hospital room, is like a rectangular solid, right? Like,
yes.
A cube. It seemed to me that the room changed configuration to where I felt that I was kind of at the center point of a funnel, and the light in the room was something else. I mean, we have to say light because it appears like light, but it's not exactly of the same dimension of existence, I think. But you have to call it light.
It's the mystical light, really.
Yes, yes, yes. And this complete compassion and love. And, to get directly to the point from that, having an experience like that kind of short-circuited my curiosity, you know what I mean? In the sense that since I'd had it before, I guess I couldn't maintain the distance anymore that I'm accustomed to when I'm thinking or writing about a subject. So that was the story of, you know, of how I eventually got around to writing this book.
And your whole family saw it, your brothers and sisters. It wasn't
just you. Well, yes, that's right. Those of us who were there.
So the energy was so powerful in that room.
It was quite amazing. I was...
How fortunate you are.
Yes, and also now I can empathize in an entirely new way with people who talk to me about these experiences.
It's totally different when you have the experience.
It is. I think a major breakthrough in true rational investigation of the question of an afterlife. I mean, I think, you know, if you're going to resort to reason at all on a question like this, you know, it deserves the best, most careful reasoning you got, right?
Absolutely.
My first thought as a child was that when you die, it's just like the body disintegrates and the consciousness goes to zero. So the first thing we think, I think, in childhood sort of sticks with us. So it's been a long process with me to come to some sort of judgment on this, but now I really am, I feel that inwardly to me, when I try to say anything other than, there does seem to be a state of existence after death, I feel that I'm running away or rationalizing rather than just to straightforwardly state what seems to be. And I got to admit, it's getting...
curiouser and curiouser.
Yes, it really does. It's like a black hole. The closer you get to the center of it, the more bewildering it comes.
That's true. You had a very interesting story in here also about the Canadian doctor's dead patient who he saw looking at his own body, and the doctor saw him in an out-of-body state.
Yes, yes.
Tell us about that. That's so interesting.
I've heard many like this. This is something that you can hear from many doctors who will tell you that when a patient dies, and it does not have to be a patient they already knew, although in the case of the Canadian doctor that you mentioned, it was a man that he already had a relationship with. This was his patient. But in other cases, medical doctors have reported this who just happened in, and they were, you know, they were called to see this patient they had never seen before. And so what people will say is that it's as though a transparent duplicate of the person kind of stands up or gets up and away from the body and may seem to look back at the body and look at it to be, you know, to sort of...
wonderment, probably.
Yeah, right, and awe. Then another thing that a lot of doctors have told me is that at the moment of death, they see what seems to be like a golden grayish cloud, for want of a better term, move up away from the usually the top part of the person's body around the head or the chest. And so there seem to be these two slightly different takes on it, but it may be also just a difficulty of language, because people say that really there aren't any accurate terms for saying it anyway. So whether you say it's a transparent duplicate of the person or a golden gray form with complex action going on in it, is how this is described. It may be descriptions of the same indescribable experience.
You sound very sympathetic for everybody.
Well, the skeptics do, you know, they do a service in trying to keep the debate about this kind of thing honest. But the trouble is they're not real skeptics, and that sort of makes it difficult for me to teach my students of ancient Greek philosophy what a skeptic is. But
what is a skeptic then?
Well, basically,
I mean, I know the normal term.
The skeptical movement came from ancient Greek philosophy, and it arose in the wake of Aristotle. And basically, Aristotle was the person who codified logic. A matter of fact, the same logic that we use in our daily affairs, reasoning about things, and the same logic that's the basis of the academic disciplines and the sciences. And so, in effect, you could say that Aristotle taught us a procedure for drawing conclusions. But the skeptics were philosophers who came along after that and said, well, what if we don't draw the conclusion? That's the essence of being a skeptic. And they even had manuals designed to to keep you from drawing a conclusion that there's a table in front of you. You know, it might be a cardboard cutout or an optical illusion or whatever. And they found that by practicing this assiduously, two things would happen. Number one, they would have a very interesting experience of mind expansion, where the world really does look, I think, quite different to a skeptic. Secondly, if you think about it geometrically, if everybody else is rushing in the same direction to get to a conclusion, but your policy is to withhold a conclusion, then if you think of it geometrically, you will see that that would have the effect of opening up your peripheral vision, right?
Yes.
You're not focused ahead, but you can look down to the side pathways of inquiry that nobody else had noticed because they're heading in the same direction. Now, when knowing that, when you play back what people who falsely say that they're skeptics, they will say about near-death experiences, for example, they'll say, oh, I'm skeptical about these near-death experiences. I think it's just the chemistry of the brain. Or with respect to the kind of experiences I described in Glimpses of Eternity, my book, on shared death experiences, they would say, oh, I'm skeptical about these shared death experiences. I think it's just people being emotional or wishful thinking or whatever. Knowing what a skeptic really is, if you unpack that kind of statement, it becomes, I'm a person who doesn't draw conclusions, and my conclusion is such and such. So it's self-contradictory, and I think that in intellectual honesty, I think it's kind of time to wake up to the reality that these experiences are very common, that they're not going to go away, that they tend to transform the people to whom they happen very fundamentally.
This really is a very big transformational time for both parties.
It really is. And it's like, what do we say? I mean, it becomes a little bit embarrassing to try to avoid just going ahead and saying, well, there does seem to be something after death.
That's right, and I think that it's almost you just have to keep your faith, learn as much as you can, speak to as many people, and put the facts down. And from there, let people draw their conclusions, because, like you say, thousands, maybe millions of people are having these experiences. Something very interesting you mentioned in your book, Life After Life, you said that Emanuel Swedenborg, the Swedish mystic, alluded to the fact that sometimes when someone dies, they don't realize they've died for a while. You know, sometimes it can be a few weeks or months or even years. And this is also emphasized, as you know, in the Tibetan Book of the Dead, which you mentioned.
Yeah.
So how does a person help a loved one cross over? And what can we learn, you know, before death to ensure that this doesn't happen to us, that we get lost or we get confused for a while?